you know.
Of
It's
course, of
just a
course.
question which want to show little deeper understanding.
Yeah, it was a good question. I'm not complaining about it.
Yeah, and some students complain about it, but I like it. Okay. Give me 1 second and we will start the class. But the reason I'm asking you is, this is the first time I gave an exam this way, okay? So maybe it was too easy to do it, or it was far too long and you didn't have enough time to answer your question, okay? The reason why I'm asking you for the feedback is there will be three more exams, okay? 2 more midterm exams and final exams. So I can adjust it, but I need your feedback. If you don't tell me anything, you know, if you found it, you know, a little too long, too many questions by far, overwhelming, you know, to do it on computer this way, let me know. I can adjust the next exam. But if you don't give me any feedback, you know, I cannot adjust the score, I cannot respond to your content, etc.
Yeah, if I may just add one more thing, I did feel a bit of a time constraint. Just because, you know, reading the questions, understanding the questions, and then formulating my answer, and then not knowing whether my answers were specific enough, and then debating the back and forth, I did feel a bit of a time constraint. But yeah, that's just me. Maybe a bit more time, or a fewer amount of questions. Not much less than what I believe it was 8 questions.
Yeah, I think it was 8.
Maybe like 6 or 7, I felt like I would have had enough time to formulate everything, but and then like I said before, for example.
Okay. Is there anything anyone wants to say?
I think that if you didn't give us like those extra 15 minutes to like download and then upload, then I think that would have a little bit of like time constraint. But for me, at least I was able to check it twice. Well, once. Do it and do it once. But because of, like, also those 15 minutes, which helped.
Yeah, I agree with that, definitely. Because without the last 15 minutes, I don't think I would have been able to either finish all the questions or maybe not able to go over my answers and feel comfortable with them before I submit.
I thought it was fun. For me as well, I almost didn't finish one of the questions.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a fair test, in my opinion.
Speak up. I don't think I mention it in this class. I always do it because if you would take the class on the campus with me, you would already realize I'm extremely bad remembering the student's name. It gets a little easier, at least for you who speaks up, because I see your faces, so I can connect the faces with the names. But if I have you in the classroom, I don't have this advantage. So I'm extremely bad, you know, connecting the names with the faces. So when I'm grading the exams, I have no idea for whom I grade. So I try to always tell students, it's not, don't take it from me as a rude or unpolite. It's just some people are great, you know, they see somebody, they remember name for the rest of the life. I'm not like that. But take it like your advantage, because there is zero bias. So if you tell me something now, I'm not going to hold it against you for the rest of the class, because, you know, I don't remember the name and connect it with the faces. So don't be, and the reason why I'm telling you this is don't be afraid to speak up, okay? This is giving you the chance, you know, to go and make the exams, which may be, I wouldn't say easier, but, you know, a little better for you to answer, okay? I don't want to giving you the exams which are extremely long and nobody can answer, you know, 30% of questions, okay? But, you know, it's certain adjustments for you taking the class remotely this way, making, you know, doing exams remotely. Certain adjustment for me as well, so I really appreciate any of your feedback. Nothing more? I don't think it was tricky, so I can make it harder. No, I'm just joking. Okay, so let's go back to chapter 5. What I want to do today is I want to finish chapter 5 in the first part. In the first part of the class, and go and continue with chapter 7 in the second part of the class, because as I mentioned previously, this is the summer class. It's a lot of stuff, it goes really fast, and we just how the classes, how many lectures there are, we do not have so much time, so we really cannot, you know, cannot spend. We really cannot spend too much time on everything. We have to go and advance the classes. The chapter 5 is a little strange because it's like all those different techniques for manipulation of DNA and RNA together. It's a lot of stuff which overlays with the topics which are usually covered in molecular biology or maybe some of your biology classes. So, and it's covered again much more in detail if you are taking the biology too. So the next step, next techniques we have to address is PCR. And you may hear about PCR already. What does the PCR do?
It amplifies a gene.
The amplifies a gene. Can somebody be a little more specific?
It grows DNA strands.
It grows DNA strands, yes. And so we use a PCR if we have certain amount of DNA sequence, and we would like it to amplify to obtain a larger amount of DNA for sequencing, other experiences, etc. The PCR is coming from polymerase chain reactions. We will see later that several reactions which repeat, leading to a high multiplication sequence. It's an in vitro procedure, so the DNA is synthesized in vitro. Based on the template you would like to multiply and or you would like to amplify, the size of DNA typically ranges between 100 to 300 base pairs long. You start with double-strand DNA, and this is what you want to do, what you want to modify your DNA. The first step is strand separation, because DNA polymerase needs only single strand to set in place. To separate DNA, you increase the temperature. This is the same as when we spoke about DNA unfolding. The increase of the temperature separates the two strands. And you do it by heating solution to 95 degrees Celsius for a short time, like 15 seconds. DNA polymerase, as you remember from previous chapters, requires the presence of primers. So when in the presence of primers, when cooling back your solution with your sequence, DNA sequence, the primers hybridize to DNA strains, and one primer hybridizes on the C-prime end of the target strain, the second one hybridizes on the 5' end of the complementary strains. The DNA duplexes do not form because the primers are presented in the excess. Okay, so since you have much more primer, each separated strain has a larger probability to hybridize with the primer than with the original DNA strains. Those primers are usually 20 to 30 nucleotides or bases long.
The other thing
happens at 72 degrees Celsius, and it's usually a TAC polymerase, which is used for DNA synthesis. It's the polymerase, DNA polymerase, which is isolated for Thermus aquaticus, which is a thermophilic bacterium which lives in the hot paint. And the DNA polymerase elongates both primers in the direction of target sequence in the 5' to 3' directions, and DNA takes synthesis on both strands but extends beyond the target sequence. This is something I will show you on the next page. Once the these steps happen, in the same test tube, the same sample, DNA is again heated up. Those two strains, the parental strain and loop strains, are separated, hybridized with the primers, and now you have two times more templates. So the number of DNA which is synthesized in the next step increases. So let's go here.
Yes.
I took this somewhere from NIH web page because I quite like this picture. So this is your.
I just saw myself walking.
This
you
is the strength.
I mean,
like,
I catch
you
every once in a while.
Using PCR. So you increase the temperature to 95 degrees Celsius. Those two parental strains are separated, and because you have excess of primers, during cooling, those primers hybridize with the single strain DNA. And here on one template, and the yellow one on the second template. Now, you increase the temperature and the stack polymerase can synthesize a new strain based on the original template. And you get the new strains which are shown in blue right here. So from initial two copies, you get four strain DNA. In the next cycle, you separate those copies into individual strains. They hybridize with primer exactly the same. Synthesizing DNA, and the new DNA here is shown in green. And if you look at this picture right here, you are coming to one situation because the orange strains are the parental strains, and they are a little longer than the newly synthesized strains because the primers does not hybridize exactly at the beginning of the parental strain. Okay, so you are within this part here, and when it synthesizes the new DNA using this template, the yellow primer now will hybridize right here. You are going to be getting a new strain, which size is exactly determined by the position of the primers. And this will be shown here on this green strain and here. And now everything is repeating. You are getting more and more copies. Some of those copies are exactly those shorter strains as shown right here in the brown color and the dark green color. And you will still get few of them which are a little longer ones. If you do 20 to 3 cycles, you are going to get millions and million copies. During the three-step strain separation, hybridization, and DNA synthesis continues, it's repeating just by changing the temperature. Because the temperature goes up and down, allowing denaturation, hybridization with primer, and synthesis. After the third cycle, you start to see those short segments, which shows the DNA sequence just between the two primers, and multiplying those during all those 20-30 cycles, the size of them is increasing geometrically, exponential. There's an exponential growth. There are the long strands, which are shown here, maybe this blue strand, etc. Our this green strand right here, they will also grow, but only arithmetically. So the PCR allows to multiply DNA segments, DNA sequences very fast and in very high quantities. Are there any questions? Are there any questions?
Do you mind recording the lecture, Professor, please?
Sorry, I forgot. Thank you.
Oh, good.
You should remind me earlier. I'm sorry. Yeah, I know. Are there any questions to PCR?
What do you mean by like the DNA polymerase hybridized to the primer?
No, DNA polymerase is going to bind. So the hybridization is the process when two strains of DNA go back to each other, two single strain DNA goes to each other, to each, for hybridization to happen, these two strains have to have a complementary sequence. If there is no complementary sequence, they are not going to hybridize. So the hybridization is in the step which is shown right here. In the step which is shown right here, these steps, the primers hybridize to DNA because their sequence is complementary to the DNA template. Okay? If you would separate two strains of DNAs by increasing temperature and cool the solution down, you would cool the solution down in the absence of primers, those two DNA strains would come back together through the hybridization because their sequence is complementary. But the DNA polymerase binding, this is not called the hybridization.
Thank you.
Okay, any more questions?
Professor, I have a question. So, let's say we get like the four copies, right?
Yes.
When we have the four copies and we try to get the original strand back together, will the complementary shorter strands that match get together and the bigger ones get together, or do they just stay where they are in size? Doesn't matter.
Oof. So. You don't try to get them together.
Okay.
Because let's say you are in this step, you have those two copies.
Mm-hmm.
So now you heat it to 95 degrees Celsius, and from those four strands, you get like four individual strands, and each of those strands serves as a template. So you don't want them to come back together. You want them to bind a primer, each of them. So the orange one binds the purple primer here. The blue one here binds the yellow primer here, etc. You want them to bind the primers and to serve as template for the new DNA synthesis, new DNA replication.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
More questions? So why do we need PCR? Let's say you can use it as an assay to determine the presence of the infectious agents, bacteria, prenatal diagnosis of genetic diseases. As I mentioned previously, the baby DNA can be isolated from mother's DNA, mother's blood, so you can have the prenatal diagnosis and test for genetic of babies before they are born. You can use it for direct cloning from genomic DNA and complementary DNA. So if you have a piece of the genomic DNA, you can clone it, multiply it. You can increase the amount of rare DNA by PCR if you have some short DNA segments. Very rare one, you can increase these quantities. The technique, which is called RT-PCR, use RNA as a template, and it can be also modified. The amplification happens through synthesis of DNA. You can use it for in vitro mutagenesis and engineering of DNA, and we will speak about in vitro mutagenesis. You can use it for genetic fingerprinting of forensic samples, a sample of hair found on the crime scenes. You can use it to isolate DNA, amplify the DNA from this one hair, to use it for sequencing later. You can use it in sequence of the genes to characterize the changes in the allelic variations. If you want to determine if somebody carries some genetic disease, etc. So the PCR amplifications, the PCR has large number of different applications, not only in forensic chemistry, you know, the trying to get somebody who committed the crime, but in medicine, the other term I would like to mention here is the DNA library and complementary DNA. If you look at the size of DNA, of human DNA, the size of human DNA is really large, and only small amount of our human DNA genomes carry codes for the proteins. So it's used to synthesize messenger RNA and, you know, obtain it protein-based on algorithm. There is a part of the DNA which are regulatory DNA. There are part of the DNA we really still don't know what are their functions. Sometimes it's called junk DNA. But we are often interested in DNA which codes for proteins, which are then expressed in the cells. So to do that, we speak about so-called complementary DNA. And sometimes if you see a cDNA, the C, the little case C letter here, does not mean circular DNA, it means complementary DNA. And the DNA is such complementary DNA is obtained by copying a messenger RNA with introns that are usually removed. So how we can make a complementary DNA? First, we need to isolate messenger RNA. And we already talked about it, we can take advantage that messenger RNA has poly-L tag, so we can use the DT, oligo-DT, or oligo-DU cellulose to characterize messenger RNA. Using reverse transcriptase, the sequence of messenger RNA is transcribed into the DNA. The messenger RNA strain can be removed by an AOH, just getting single-stranded complementary DNA, and this complementary DNA can be replicated into double-strand DNA, and the double-strand DNA can be then cloned into the cloning vectors like any other molecules and serve as a DNA library. So if we have a DNA library, we have large amount of vectors, and which vector is going to carry one complementary DNA or a part of complementary DNA to with the idea that you will have all the complementary DNAs from one genome carried by several, by thousands of vectors. So if we speak about genomic library, it would be a library which have every single piece from genomic DNA, from the DNA of a single organism. And this may be bacteria, this may be plant, this may be some mammal. So mammal genome has 3 to 4 billion base pairs of DNA. One gene is about 10 kilobase pairs. So it's unpractical to isolate as one single gene from DNA. So if we want to prepare genomic DNA library, we want to have sequences of DNA which cover all the DNA and all the genes. And so, as I said, it would be not practical to isolate every single gene. So instead of this, we try to get the library of fragments of DNA. And we are looking for the probability that certain fragments will have certain genes. So to prepare a genomic DNA library, we need to isolate total DNA. And once we isolate all the DNA, we apply so-called shotgun cloning. So we digest the total DNA into a fragments of suitable sizes. And those fragments we can then put in some vectors, which can be bacteriophage vector, yeast vector, or plasmid vector if they would be small. But we do it randomly. This is the reason why it's called shotgun. We just don't care exactly where the genes will start or finish. We just break DNA in small fragments. And we are hoping that we have so many fragments that certain fragments will correspond to certain genes. Those fragments are inserted into vectors or bacteriophage, and we will have the large number of vectors or the large number of bacteriophage and their enzymes cover all genomic DNA library. Now, each plasmid is then taken up by bacteria, and we can use bacteria to multiply all those vectors. And we will have the total bacterial population, which then represent the entire human genome. And the question now is, how many fragments we need to have to make sure that every single gene is presented at least once in one fragment or in one plasmid in this genomic library. And the probability is expressed using this equation or this formula right here. So the probability is 1 minus, and in parentheses there is 1 minus f of n, but f is the fraction of desired sequence in the genome, and the n is the number of fragments. So we can rewrite this equation using the equation here. So n is log of 1 minus p divided log of 1 minus f. So let's do a little example to make a sense of this equation. So how many is DNA fragments of average length of 5,000 base pair has to be cloned in order to have 99% probability that a genomic library will contain certain sequence? And the East genome is 12 times 10 to 6 base pair. So the fraction of desired sequence in the genome is going to be the length of the fragments, which is 5,000 base pair, divided by the size of the East genome, which is right here, which is going to be 4 times 10 to the minus. So the probability that the fragment of 5 kilobytes pair is going to be in East genome is 4 times 10 to the minus 4. Its fraction is 4 times 4. And the number of fragments you need to get to have the probability to be 99% is then log of 1 minus 0.99 divided by log of 1 minus f, this is the fraction of desired sequence, which is 4 times 13 10 to minus 4, which is 11,000. So you need to have over 11,000 of 5,000 base pair fragments to make sure that at least one gene, that this desired sequence is at least once in all your library. Does it make sense? Okay. So making those libraries and sequencing, the genome of many organisms has been completed. Human gene sequences was done, finished in 2004. Actually, there was officially it was completed a little earlier, and it was announced by President Clinton, but they really finished in 2004. There is 3 billion of base pairs, only 20 to 25,000 genes code for protein. Additional sequence is so-called pseudogene, sometimes called junk sequence. There is a large amount of this non-coding sequence. For a large number of sequences, we really still don't know what this DNA is doing. And I wouldn't say that the DNA is completely useless there. However, it may take some time for us to discover what its real function. One interesting part about DNA are so-called mobile genetic elements. There are some elements in our DNA which can jump and self-insert into DNA. I'm not going to talk about it anything more. This is again part of the biological chemistry too, but it's a cool stuff. There's a little in 50s of the last century. Nobody believed her for years and years, but yeah, there are some elements, just jumping elements, base sequences in our DNA, which have capability to get out of DNA genome and self-insert it back into DNA. The other technique I want to mention is side-directed mutagenesis. the way how to modify the DNA and the way how to modify certain amino acid residues in DNA. So right now, the example I have here right now is, you are working with a protein and you would like to determine if this residue in the active center is really important for enzymatic activity. So if the residue, let's say tyrosine, is a key residue for enzymatic activity, if you replace it by different residue, let's say alanine, your enzyme or the modified protein should lose the enzymatic activity. So how would you do such replacement? So you have a plasmid, and in your plasmid you have a gene, which is called protein, and now you would like to change two positions, or three nucleotides here is the example. So you would like to replace one of the T bases by G. So the complementary to this T originally is A, but you would like to insert C here, and here you would like to replace AG by CA. So in the complementary strand, you insert GT. So you take the plasmid, you make a single DNA plasmid, and you add a short segment of DNA, which has certain mismatches, but there should be only few of them. Okay, you cannot have too many mismatches. And once, because there are only few mismatches, the rest of this primer hybridizes DNA, you add a DNA polymerase, all the other co-substrate you need for DNA polymerase, magnesium, deoxy-ATP, deoxy-CTP, deoxy-CTP, deoxy-DTP, and the polymerases synthesize the complementary strain. So all the rest of the complementary strain is analogous or complementary to the DNA. You just have those three base mismatch. Now you can separate those two strains, let it multiply again, and at the end you isolate the plasmid, which has the mutation. Now you take the plasmid with altered gene, insert it into bacteria, transform the bacteria. You can let the altered gene to be expressed, the altered protein to be expressed, and you can characterize the function of certain amino acid residue. So this is the basic approach of the site-directed mutagenesis. The other way how to do it is you use hazard mutation. So instead of has this primer right here, you have the plasmid. You cut off a part of the plasmid using transcription enzyme, and you add a new DNA, which has the analogous sticky ends, and the part of the DNA you inserted carry the mutation, and you use ligase to ligate it to the plasmid. So this is the other possibility how to prepare mutations. Why is it important to mutate protein? You can prepare new proteins. You can prepare chimeric proteins. And chimeric proteins are proteins which have one part, one domain from one protein, other domain from the other protein. You can use it to prepare synthetic vaccines, which are non-infectious code proteins of viruses, etc. So the formation of the mutations have many possible implications. Some example is GST fusion protein. If you have a protein of interest, you will covalently attach to it glutathione S transferase. And you do it by glutathione S transferase is an additional protein. So you put a GST sequence, you incorporate it into expression vector alongside the gene sequence which encodes for the protein you want to express. And once you express your protein of the interest, you express two proteins which are covalently attached to each other, glutathione S transferase and the protein of interest. And why do you do it? Because glutathione S transferase has high affinity for the tripeptide, which is called glutathione. And during the purification, you have a column, and the beads are modified, has attached this tripeptide. So the glutathione S transferase strongly binds to this tripeptide, and which allows you to purify and isolate your protein. Now, the other advantage of attachment of glutathione S transferase making GST fusion protein is it increases the solubility of the protein of interest, so sometimes it helps to purify the proteins which otherwise likes to form in fusion bodies. I have very fast here one example of the chimeric protein, which is so-called chameleon calcium sensor. I don't know how much, I just like this idea, what they did, and we still have some time. So how it works, so you have the, you want to measure calcium within the cells, and those measurements are not easy. You cannot have like calcium electrode inserted into the cell because you would kill the cell. Okay, so you need to have some molecule which would be in the calcium, and their properties would be changing as a function of calcium concentration. I'm sorry, my nose is running through. So, how do you do it? Why calcium? Calcium is important secondary messenger. It involves in a regulation of many processes. Just to show you how important calcium as a ion is in our cell. Outside of cell, the concentration of calcium is about 1 millimolar, 2 millimolars, but inside of cell keeps the concentration of calcium very low, about 100 nanomol, under resting conditions. Upon stimulus of the cells, which may be such a binding of the hormones, the concentration of calcium may increase 10 to 100 times, so up to 1 to 10 micromolar, and calcium binds to certain protein and starts to regulate the different processes, which may be replication of the cells, a growth of the cells, cells death, muscle contractions. Calcium is involved in large and multiple processes. So really, we really need a system which would allow us to monitor changes in concentration of calcium in the living cell. And this system is shown right here. So this chimeric protein, it's composed of three different proteins. So the gene, which is inserted into the plasmid, and in case it was baculovirus transfer, has a promoter. It has a gene for cyan fluorescent protein, which is one of the derivative of green fluorescent protein, which emits blue light. It has a sequence for calmodulin or modified calmodulin, calmodulin and serine. Calmodulin is protein which binds calcium with relatively high affinity. The dissociation constant is about 1 micromolar, and it has a yellow fluorescent protein. Again, it's analog of green fluorescent protein, but the yellow fluorescent protein emits yellow light. So if you insert the DNA or such protein in your cell, the DNA is transcribed into messenger RNA, and the messenger RNA is used as a template, so the cell synthesizes this calcium sensor. And you have this structure right here again. The blue is the cyanide fluorescent protein, cyanine fluorescent protein, yellow fluorescent protein, and the calmodulin is in the center. The mechanism of sensing is coming from faster resonance energy transfer, and I'm not expecting to be fast, but just shortly because this is cool. So if you have this the blue fluorescent protein right here, and you illuminate it with the UV light, let's say 380 nanometers. If this protein is far from the yellow fluorescent protein, you will see the blue emission. However, if the yellow fluorescent protein comes close to the blue fluorescent protein. The yellow fluorescent protein emits yellow light. And even if you do not excite the yellow fluorescent protein, you excite the blue fluorescent protein. The excitation of blue fluorescent protein leads to the excitation of the chromophore or fluorophore in this blue fluorescent protein. But because those two proteins are close, and they have certain additional properties which are favorable, the energy from the blue protein is transferred to the yellow protein. And now instead of seeing yellow emission, you will see, instead of seeing blue emission, you are going to see only yellow emission, which shows you that those two proteins are close to each other. Now, why they come close to each other? In the absence of calcium, if there is no calcium, this calmodulin protein in the middle has an elongated structure. So the yellow blue fluorescent protein and yellow fluorescent protein are far apart, and you see only the blue emission. If the concentration of calcium in the cell increases, calcium binds palmodulin changes the structure, it brings those two fluorescent proteins close to each other. So exciting the blue fluorescent protein, you are getting yellow emissions, which allows you nicely monitor the changes in the calcium concentration in the cell. Are there any questions?
Is that what you use for calcium imaging?
You can use it for calcium imaging, yeah. And the process is reversible. So once the concentration of calcium decreases, calcium is released from calmodulin and you don't see any emission again. So you can see like changes in the emission can be like oscillating up, down, up, down, up, down, which directly monitor. We have several examples how to modify DNA in the organisms. As you already know, there are several genetic diseases which are associated with the modification of gene. We may speak about some in, we will speak about one in chapter 7 when we speak about hemoglobin. But there is something like a cystic fibrosis. There are some other diseases. And the problem is these diseases are part of the genome and it's difficult to change the genome. Okay? And if you look at the textbook, there are several approaches. The one I want to show is the newest one, which looks like the best system which has been discovered so far. And it's so-called CRISPR system. And it was discovered that in bacteria, in genome of the bacteria, they were found some cluster regulatory interspace palindromic repeats, and there was this, the enzyme which is called Cas enzyme, which was found to bind to those DNA repeats and cleave it. And so based on this, there was a new system which was developed. So the enzyme work in such ways that the enzyme is composed of the protein and also from RNA. And the RNA has to be complementary to the DNA, which is going to be cut out. So the CRISPR-Cas systems binds to DNA and cut it at certain well-defined sequences. And the fact that this is guided by RNA molecule means that if we change the sequence of the RNA molecule, it can change, it can vary things for DNA. So we can program this CRISPR-Cas system able to recognize particular DNA sequence and make the break at certain part. Now we can also use the donor DNA, which would be inserted into, which would be reinserted into DNA, into the part which was cut out, and can repair broken DNA. So Cas9 has DNA, and repair system takes this donor DNA and insert it into the Cas site. So this is one way how to repair DNA. All these stuff really open possibilities how to modify DNA in humans, in animals, etc. CRISPR system have been used for modifying several plants already. If I recall well, one problem is those genetically modified tomatoes are they do not smell so well. They don't have the right tomato smell. But the advantage of them is they you can store them for much longer time in the public shelf. But there was a scientist like years ago at UF who used this CRISPR system, which allow to modify this the tomato such ones that they can smell nicely even on the public shelves. Okay. However, the possibilities, and there are several biotech companies who use this system how to modify human DNA and use it in medicine. There are such neuronal muscle atrophy, which is one disease, which may happen in the kids, and they lose after 2 years old, they lose the ability to walk and to move, etc. And I think this is the system which is now used or started to be used to repair the DNA in those kids. You can also imagine that there are some ethical consequences. There was the case which happened last fall, and it's running the Chinese scientist who used this system to modify the embryo of twins. And what he did, he said that he tried to repair their DNA by removing gene which is involved in HIV infection. So there are certain small amount of people which just change in their genome, so they cannot get HIV infection. So he decided to took out this part of DNA in those embryos and the twins were born. But this was really little well designed by to take it out. Chances that somebody gets HIV infections are not so high, okay? And the kids could have a normal life even without this genetic modification. Since we do not know exactly what this gene he took out does, really, we don't know what will be the consequences. So there was it was in the news quite often. I don't think it's in the news anymore. The Chinese scientist who did the work disappeared apparently. So we don't know how this will finish. But it has great opportunities in medicine, which can tackle many of gene diseases, which are associated with gene modifications, and right now we do not have any good tools how to cure them. But there are also many, many ethical questions. So last thing here in this solid phase synthesis of DNA, if you remember, we spoke about the approach that we can use solid state synthesis to synthesize proteins or short peptides, when these are combined synthesis. We can also use solid phase synthesis to synthesize DNA. Again, sometimes it's much easier if it's short to use the solid state synthesis than to use PCR, or than to use bacteria to do it for us. In addition, in PCR, we need a template for solid phase synthesis. We don't need any template because it's happening. So the DNA molecules is growing, the oligonucleotide is growing into a solid support, and the activated monomers are added. Now there should be certain protections. There's always protection of the 5' end using dimethoxytryptyl group, which is shown right here, which is attached to the oxygen 5' N. The 3' N phosphoryl group is rendered unreactive by attachment beta cyanoethyl group. As well as deoxyribonucleoside 3' phosphoramidite and here. So these are the groups which are the change triphosphate bases which are used to the solid state synthesis. So on the solid state synthesis right here, you have the base which is attached to the resin. The attachment is coming from the hydroxy group, which is on the 3' end. And so the base or the nucleotide, which is added to the resin, has three OH groups to the 5'. You add such modified activated monomer, and what you will see, there will be the reactions between the modified 3' hydroxy end and so there's the attack from the phosphorus on the 3' end and the hydroxy group which is on the 5' end on the nucleotide which is attached to the resin, and the phosphate reester intermediate which is shown right here is formed. So this is the way how the coming nucleotide is attached to the base, and here the oxidation biogene leads to the oxidation of the phosphate group, forming phosphotriester intermediate. Now, next step is the deprotections with the dichloroacetic acid. So the DMT group is removed from the 5' end, and you have the coupling reaction finished. So this type, this elongated chain can lead to the addition of new nucleotide. After each coupling reaction, the resin is washed to remove all the unreactive species, which would be the unreactive protonated nucleotides plus all the reagents. And once you've finished synthesis of the oligonucleotide, those BCE protecting group from the phosphodiester bridges now then remove this ammonium hydroxide. So unlike synthesis in vitro or in vivo, when the DNA is synthesized from 5' to 3', here you synthesize it from 3' to 5'. It goes in the opposite direction, but again you can get synthesized oligonucleotides the same way as we spoke for the proteins. Longer the oligonucleotides are, there is larger probability of the errors, so more expensive they get because the yield of the synthesis is control. Are there any questions?
What's the difference between like the CRISPR and using the restriction enzymes?
Well, the CRISPR, the restriction enzymes are going to cleave in many sites. So, but those and the restriction enzymes have relatively short recognition sequence. If you remember, it's between 4 to 8 nucleotides. So if you have a long genomic DNA, there are many sites of the restriction and where the restriction enzyme can be. Okay. Here, the complementary sequence between the guide RNA and the Cas protein is much longer. Okay. So the probability that this guide RNA will match your genomic DNA at certain places is much smaller. So you are much better selecting single place where you will start. So it provides much higher selectivity because the complementary sequence is significantly longer. More questions? So let's take a 10-minute break and we will continue with chapter 7.
Hey, baby. Mm-hmm. I'm on break, but what are you doing? Yeah, afterwards.
Huh?
I kind of want to get that impossible burger.
I kind of don't feel like I have time to leave because...
That's okay.
Yeah.
I could try and get yours for you too, but... That's you. But I'm just telling you, I would like to do that.
Right.
Okay.
You can try. So, I thought I was run all day yesterday. Wasn't enough. Missed it by 3,000.
Professor, I have a quick question.
God, scary shit.
Yes, what's your question?
On the online test number 5, where we had to match the amino acids with the characteristics, you said that some amino acids could have, like, the characteristics could have more than one amino acid, right?
All right.
Okay, just making sure.
The solution I provided online, I just mentioned one, okay? But there is a question, I think, which amino acid has sulfur atom in the side chain. So there are two possibilities, cysteine and methionine.
Did we have to put more than one, or is one okay?
No, if you put at least one correct,
sweet,
it would be okay.
Okay.
You don't have to write down all options. Actually, what I really want you just to put one and make sure that not a single one repeats. Okay.
Got it.
Because if you could just match one to one on the left side to one on the left side, having nothing repeating, then this would be correct. Do you see what I want to say?
I do, yes.
Yes, yeah. More questions. I'm here, you can ask me anything now.
No, I just keep going over my exam over and over before I submit, and I'm like, is it right?
Oh, the one which is okay?
Yeah.
That's okay.
I mean, I've been staring at it forever, like. The mind starts to do wild things, you know.
Sorry, one more time.
The mind will start to do wild things, like, is this correct?
Well, that's always like that, okay. But I don't think there is anything so tricky.
Hmm. No, it's a very good test. Like, it's difficult.
Is it difficult?
It is challenging. I don't think it's unsolvable, but it's a challenge. So I think it's a good example of an exam.
You know, and it's how it should be. It's home take exam. So you have all.
Exactly.
You have all, you know, you have more time. You have all resources, any textbook, any resource online. So that's how it should be.
I was telling someone, I'm really glad that I started the night that you, that we got it, because otherwise it'd be like, whoa.
Okay. A few more minutes.
Okay.
Professor, when is exam number 2 going to be?
I need to look at the syllabi. When is the date on the syllabi, do you know?
I think it's June 3rd.
Sorry, one more time.
June 3rd.
But let me look at the calendar. Oh, it's next Wednesday.
Yeah.
I don't think it's going to be next Wednesday. Do you know when is the last day of the semester? It's
the 21st.
June 19th.
June 21.
I think so.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure, but I think so.
June 20. Fucking A. It's June 21st. This is the last day of the semester.
Oh, yeah. So.
Yeah, but it's Sunday. I'm not going to give you final exam on Sunday. Even if you want to. So, This is the problem because this, you know, this summer semester it goes so fast, it's crazy. So I would say Friday 5 or Monday 8. Because we can have Friday 5, Friday 2nd one, Friday 12, the 3rd one, and the 19 will be the final. Okay. So looks like Friday 5, because we can at least do maybe, and it would be chapter 5, 7, 8.
Okay.
Looks like that. Okay. Thinking about it on Wednesday hurts my head, Erica. What about Friday? Does it also hurt your head, Erica?
Little less.
Little less. So, let's go to chapter number 8. So, in chapter, where is my chapter 7? In chapter 7, we will talk about two proteins, hemoglobin and myoglobin.
Oh.
The reason for it is that those two proteins have been... Can you see me and hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Because my computer something does
yes.
not like, it's like flashing. So the reason we will speak about two main proteins, myoglobin and hemoglobin, and the reason for it is that those two proteins have been used as a model protein to understand ligand binding to protein, cooperativity, and allosteric of ligand binding. So we'll speak about cooperativity, allosteric. At the end of the class, we will speak about Bohr effect, which is part of the allosteric regulation of hemoglobin binding, oxygen. So, hemoglobin is a red blood cell protein. We have it in our red blood, red cells. As you maybe know from your biology classes, red cells are little specific cells. They have those concave shapes, which increase their surface. And the function of hemoglobin is transport oxygen from the lungs, where it gets oxygen from the air to the tissue through the blood. Hemoglobin is an allosteric protein. What it means that its affinity for oxygen is regulated by binding other molecules, and it also displays cooperativity in oxygen binding. As we will see, single molecule of hemoglobin can bind four oxygen molecules, and the affinity of the oxygen molecule depends on the hemoglobin ligation state. So the oxygen, the binding of fourth oxygen molecule to hemoglobin, which has already three oxygen molecules bound, is stronger than the binding of oxygen to the hemoglobin, which does not have any oxygen molecule bound. The hemoglobin transfers oxygen to the tissues where it oxygen gets released, and here it binds to other protein, which is myoglobin. And myoglobin stored oxygen until it's necessary for the respiratory chain. The myoglobin is a monomeric protein, hemoglobin is a tetrameric protein, so hemoglobin has four oxygen binding sites, myoglobin has one oxygen binding site. The oxygen binding to myoglobin is non-cooperative, unlike hemoglobin. I will show you several or many of the saturation curve or oxygen binding curve for myoglobin and hemoglobin. When we measure oxygen binding to those proteins, we measure it as a function of pressure of oxygen. Usually when you look at the binding of two molecules together, we measure it as a function of the other concentration. But remember from Henry's law, the concentration of oxygen is proportional to the partial pressure of oxygen. So we can use either concentration of oxygen or partial pressure of oxygen for those titration experiments or titration curves. And technically, it's much easier to precisely control the partial pressure of oxygen than the concentration of oxygen. So this is the reason why we will see those curves, those plot as a function of partial pressure of oxygen instead of concentration. So the ability of myoglobin and hemoglobin to bind oxygen depends on its prostatic group, which is the protoporphyrin 9. You have the structure of protoporphyrin 9 here on the bottom. Protoporphyrin 9 is tightly bound to the protein in such ways that the active atom or active group, which binds oxygen, which is the iron in the middle of the porphyrin group, is buried inside of the protein. And only those two propionate groups, which have negative charge, they are accessible to the solvent around the side of the protein. So the prosthetic group is a heme iron prosthetic group, iron protoporphyrin 9. The iron is in the center. It's coordinated to the porphyrin group, porphyrin ring, through four bonds with nitrogen. Those are those four bonds. In addition, the heme iron can bond six ligands in total. So there are other two ligation sites which are like below this plane and above this plane, which are available. One of those sites is occupied by the nitrogen from the histidine, and the histidine is coming from the protein, as you will see later. And the sixth coordination site is empty, and this can be occupied by oxygen in the oxygen bound form. The oxygen binding has an interesting consequence. If you look at the structure of heme iron porphyrin right here, in the absence of oxygen, because there is large electron density on the iron is out of the plane. It goes like it's directed towards the histidine, which is coming from the protein, and this is so-called proximal histidine. So the iron is not exactly in the porphyrin plane, it's shifted, it's out by 0.4 angstroms. Remember, the size of the covalent bond is like 1.3 angstroms, so it's only 0.4 angstroms out. Once the oxygen binds to heme iron that pulls into the iron plane. So there is the motion which is about 0.4 angstroms. Pulling the iron into the heme, into the porphyrin plane, moves the position, changes position of the distal histidine. And this is the first step of the cooperative process of hemoglobin. And this is something we're not going back to. Now, one important thing to remember is when the porphyrin is bound to myoglobin or hemoglobin, the iron is in the iron 2 plus oxidation state. How many oxidation states can iron adopt, can iron have in the chemical compound?
Plus 2 and plus 3.
Yes, usually it's between plus 2, which is reduced iron, or plus 3 when it loses one electron and it's in the oxidized form. And this is the same in hemoglobin or myoglobin. For hemoglobin and myoglobin to be functional, the iron has to be in the iron 2 plus form. If iron is in the iron 3 plus form, it's unable to bind oxygen. Okay, so the iron has to be in iron 2 plus form. There are enzymes in our bodies which keep the iron in the iron 2 plus form. Now, the iron can be in two forms in the resonance structures, iron 2 plus, this bound oxygen, or iron 3 plus form, and in this form, the one electron from the iron goes to the oxygen forming superoxide ion, and the iron gets oxidized into iron 3 plus. If this happens, this group is reactive, the oxygen, the superoxide, leaves the heme iron atoms, and in this case, protein, either myoglobin or hemoglobin, would be in the iron surface form that it wouldn't bind oxygen anymore. So this is prevented by the fact that there is so-called additional histidine, so-called dextrohistidine. It's a different histidine than the one which is on this side, so-called dextrohistidine. And this dextrohistidine forms a hydrogen bond with the oxygenator, which stabilizes the structure of the iron 2 oxygen bond form and prevents auto-oxidation of the heme iron in the iron 3 plus form. So this is the role of the dextrohistidine. It's a different histidine than this one, which directly binds to the heme iron and it forms proximal. The dextrohistidine is too far from heme iron. It can only bind to the oxygen, but the hydrogen bond between the hydrogen from the dextrohistidine and oxygen stabilizes the iron plus water to protein. So, when we look at the structure of hemoglobin, hemoglobin is formed by four nearly identical chains. There is a chain which is called alpha chain and chain which is called beta chain. They have large sequence similarities. So those two chains have structural similarities. They are very similar to the structure of the myoglobin. They are all alpha helicoproteins. Each one has one iron porphyrin group over there. They form this complex when we usually see it as the dimer of dimers. So there is one dimer which is formed by chain alpha 1 and chain beta 1, and the second dimer which is formed by chain alpha 2 and chain beta 2. They come together forming the hemoglobin. This is the structure of hemoglobin in the oxygen-free form when the oxygen is not bound. And you can see there's a central cavity inside of the hemoglobin. And this is something we'll speak about a little later. Give me a... So, here are the titration curve. In the titration curves, we are measuring how strongly oxygen is bound to hemoglobin. And before we continue, I will go to the whiteboard. Just to remind you a few things from the general chemistry. So here we have protein, I will call it P. Something happened with my computer, everything is like blinking on me. So you can see, so we have a protein which binds ligand. Now we are talking about oxygen, but the ligand can be any other molecule, such a drug which binds to enzyme, inhibitor, etc. And those two form a non-covalent complex, I will call it PL. If you want to determine how strongly the ligand binds to the protein, what going to make? Well, if the inhibitor, if the ligand is inhibitor and it inhibits the protein, yeah, you can measure the enzymatic activity. But a little more simple, you have two molecules, they form a complex. You want to determine how strong the complex is. What parameter do you measure? Or what parameter tells you how strong the complex is? equilibrium constant or affinity constant. So the affinity constant here is going to be what? From the general chemistry. What is the definition of affinity or equilibrium constant?
PL over the concentration of PL over the concentration of P times L.
PL, concentration of PL, so concentration of product divided by product of the concentration of reactant, which looks like this. Okay. Often, we characterize the dissociation constant, which is KD, that we look at the reaction of dissociation. So we look how protein ligand complex dissociate into protein plus ligand, and the definition is 1 over Ka, which is concentration of protein multiplied by concentration of ligand divided by concentration of protein. The other parameter which is important, and we will see often in this fraction, is the fraction of protein which is in the ligand bound form. What's the definition of the fraction of protein in the ligand bound form? Somebody knows? What would be the fraction of ligand bound protein? How this would be defined? Somebody knows? So, this would be the concentration of protein in the ligand bound form, L, divided by total concentration of protein. So, I will call it PT, which is total concentration of protein, which is L, concentration of ligand bound protein, divided by concentration of protein plus concentration of the protein in the ligand bound form. Makes sense? Now, I want to express the fraction of ligand bound protein using the KD value and the concentration of ligand. So, from the equation for KD, I can write the concentration of protein in the absence of ligand is KD multiplied by concentration of protein ligand divided KD protein ligand divided by concentration of ligand. And I replace the concentration of protein by this expression in the equation for fraction of protein ligand, which is then concentration of protein ligand divided by KD multiplied by concentration of protein ligand divided by concentration of ligand plus PL. So, what I can do now, I can multiply the top and the bottom of the fraction by concentration of ligand. So I will get ligand multiplied by concentration by PL on the top, and on the bottom, I will get KD L plus PLM. Okay. If you look at this equation, we have PL on the top and on the bottom of the fractions, they cancel. And what I will get is concentration of ligand divided by KD plus concentration of ligand. Everyone can flow? Does it make sense? So, we can express the fraction of ligand bound protein by this equation, concentration of ligand divided by KD plus concentration of ligand. If I plot the fraction of protein as a function of concentration of ligand, what type of the curve I'm going to get? What type of function is this one?
Is it an S-curve?
Sorry?
An S-curve?
No, it's not an S-curve. It's not a sigmoidal curve. So I want to plot. Oh, it's better. Okay, so I will just erase some part. So what type of curve is it? Somebody remember from the class? From your calculus class or math class? So it's the hyperbole. Okay, or saturation curve. So if we are plotting, fraction of the protein in the ligand bound form as a function of concentration of ligand, we should get this type of. It's a saturation curve. Of course, by definition, the fraction of protein in the ligand bound form can be goes from 0 to 1. Okay. And so at high concentration of ligands, this curve is approaching to 1. Okay. Oh no. So this curve is approaching to 1 at high concentration of ligand. Okay. Now there is one important parameter, and you can get it if you plug it in your equation. The concentration of ligand is equal to Kd for a fraction of the protein-bound ligand to be 0.5. Well, this is Kd. Kd corresponds to the concentration of ligand when a fraction of protein ligand bound form is 0.5. Okay. Only there are some limits. It's true when the concentration of protein is much smaller than Kd. Okay. But in general, remember, the Kd corresponds to the concentration of ligand when the fraction of ligand bound protein is 0.5. So if ligand binds to the protein with Kd equal 10 micromolar, you need to add 10 micromolar of ligand to have 50% of protein to be in the ligand-bound form and 50% of protein to be in the ligand form. Does it make sense? So this is the saturation curve. It's a simpler mathematical description how the fraction of protein bound to the ligand changes with the ligand concentration if there is a single ligand binding site on the protein. And I will be showing you those types of curves right now. So go to different type of sharing. Where is it? Where is I close it here. So here is the example for ligand bind to myoglobin, more specifically oxygen binding to myoglobin. As I mentioned previously, we can talk about concentration. In case of gases, it's easier to talk about the partial pressure. But partial pressure or concentration doesn't really matter, okay? It's almost the same parameter, just the numbers are different. So here we have oxygen bind to myoglobin. This is the titration curve. It's a hyperbole saturation curve, which indicate there is only a single binding site, non-cooperative oxygen binding to the protein. The 50% saturation or fractional saturation to be 0.5 happens when the concentration of, when the partial pressure of oxygen is too low. Now, if you measure the similar graph for hemoglobin, so you plot the fractional saturation as a function of oxygen bound to hemoglobin, you don't get this hyperbole. You don't get a saturation curve or the hyperbolic curve. Instead of that, you get a sigmoidal curve, which indicates that the binding of oxygen to hemoglobin is cooperative. Okay? And we will speak about the mathematical description of such curve a little later. Okay? So oxygen binding and oxygen release is cooperative. At low concentration of oxygen, the affinity is low. At high concentration of oxygen, the affinity for oxygen is higher. The partial pressure of oxygen, the fractional saturation is 0.5, 26 torr. So the affinity of oxygen to hemoglobin is roughly 10 times weaker than affinity of oxygen for myoglobin. Okay? And remember, the fractional saturation 0.5 happens at concentration or partial pressure of oxygen, which correspond to Kd. Higher the Kd, lower affinity. Okay? Kd is 1 over Ka. So higher Kd value, lower the affinity. Higher the affinity, lower Kd value. The protein, which has Kd for ligand to be 1 nanomolar, has higher affinity for ligand than the protein, which has Kd value to be 1 millimolar. And this graph right here shows you why there is a cooperative binding of oxygen to hemoglobin, and also it shows you why the affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen is different for myoglobin. So what we mentioned previously is hemoglobin binds oxygen in the lungs. It's transported by the blood to the tissue where it releases the oxygen, and the oxygen is bound to myoglobin. So the partial pressure of oxygen in the lungs is about 100 torr. At this partial pressure, all hemoglobin is oxygen. In the almost all hemoglobin is in the oxygen bound form. Okay? Because we are close to saturation. Now hemoglobin is transported into tissue, and the partial pressure of tissue in oxygen is 20. So when hemoglobin goes into the tissue, because the oxygen concentration is low, 66% of hemoglobin releases the oxygen. Okay, so oxygen is released from the hemoglobin, but at this partial oxygen pressure of 20 torr, the myoglobin has still high affinity for oxygen. The myoglobin is like 85% oxygen bound. So the oxygen goes from hemoglobin to myoglobin.
Sorry, are you recording the lesson, the lecture?
I think so.
It doesn't show.
Okay.
I know it said it earlier.
No, okay, I do not.
I thought it said it earlier.
Thank you.
So, so if we are at this graph here, at this graph here, why it's cooperative? If the oxygen binding would two hemoglobin would be non-cooperative, and this is just hypothetical, the binding curve would look like a blue curve. Okay? In such case, in the partial pressure of oxygen, which corresponds to the concentration of oxygen in lungs, only roughly 60% of hemoglobin would be in the oxygen-bound form, and at concentration of oxygen, amount of oxygen which corresponds to the concentration of oxygen in the tissue, there would be the same, about 25% bound. So the difference between bound and unbound would be only 30%. Whereas the cooperative binding of oxygen causes that the difference between oxygen bound in the lung, hemoglobin in the lung, and oxygen bound for the hemoglobin in the tissue is 66%. So when the hemoglobin gets into the tissue, the oxygen is released much more efficiently. Okay? We will see such sigmoidal curve as shape curve when we will speak about allosteric regulation of enzyme as well. The importance is, even if you look at this graph, you can see it here, the importance of such cooperative binding is that the form of the protein from fully bound oxygen hemoglobin, fully saturated oxygen hemoglobin, to nearly unbound hemoglobin happens across the small range of concentration of oxygen. Okay? If the binding wouldn't be cooperative, and if you would follow the blue curve, the fully bound hemoglobin, the partial pressure of oxygen would have to be maybe 500 fold. Okay? So to go to full bound, to 20% bound only, you would go through the range of oxygen, concentration of oxygen pressures from 20 to 500. Okay? Since the curve is sigmoidal, you go between fully bound oxygen to 25% oxygen, only changing the pressure of oxygen to be from 20 to 100. Okay? So it's much more efficient switching between oxygen-bound hemoglobin and oxygen-unbound hemoglobin. But this is something we will talk about later. So what is the cooperativity of oxygen binding coming from? And there have been several models, and there are certain data we know from the X-ray structure. So the basic description is right here. So the quaternary structure of oxygen is different for those two states. If the hemoglobin is in the oxygen-free form, so not a single of its four prosthetic group has oxygen bound, we speak about so-called deoxyhemoglobin, deoxy, it doesn't have oxygen, and here is the structure, okay? And you can see there is the center cavity inside of the protein. Upon oxygen bounding to all four heme groups, the hemoglobin changes its structure because the top dimer, the alpha 1, beta 1 dimer, rotates by 15 degrees with respect to the bottom dimer, the alpha 2, beta 2 dimer. So this part rotates, as you have shown it here by the arrow, which leads to the conformational change and closing of the cavity. In this conformation, so-called arc structure, oxygen binds, hemoglobin binds oxygen much more easily than in this conformation, which is so-called conformation. So this alteration of structure or alteration of conformation converts oxygen from the T structure, T state, to R state, and T state has low affinity for oxygen, R state has high affinity for oxygen. Conversion into the R state facilitates oxygen binding. So, there have been certain, so I show you the model where fraction for of ligand bound is concentration of ligand divided by sum of concentration of ligand plus KD. So this model describes well the hyperbolic curve, single oxygen molecule binding to myoglobin, but it does not describe the sigmoidal curve. And there have been several models how to describe or how to model cooperative oxygen binding to hemoglobin. There are two main ones, which is so-called concerted binding and sequential binding, and then we will talk about those two. However, there have been several different models proposed, and we still do not have a model which would well describe all the characteristics of oxygen binding hemoglobin. Now, it seems that the hemoglobin cooperativity really incorporates both aspects of this model. So we see part of the concerted model, part of the sequential model. Let's start with the concerted model and pay a little attention right here. So in the concerted model, the hemoglobin can be in the T state, which is shown here, like here on the top. And when it's in T state, the conformation of the T state is shown like a square. So in hemoglobin, every single subunit, alpha 1, beta 1, alpha 2, beta 2, every single one is in the T state, which is shown like a square. Or hemoglobin can be in the R state, when each subunit adopts R state and it shows like a circle. Now the importance of concerted model, and this is the reason why it's called concerted, either all subunits are in the T state, as shown here on the top, or all subunits are in R state. Okay. You cannot have a mixture when you would have the two subunits in the T state and two subunits in the R state. Okay. Does it make sense? Now, let's say you have hemoglobin in the solution, in your test tubes, and there is no oxygen added. So all hemoglobin is in the deoxysystem. When all hemoglobin is in the deoxysystem, it's mainly T state is strongly failing. So 99.9% of your hemoglobin is in the T state, which has low affinity for oxygen, and only very small fraction between the acids. Okay? Now when oxygen binds, the hemoglobin, let's say it binds to the first subunit, because the oxygen binds, a fraction of the hemoglobin now adopt R state. Okay. But again, when it's adopt R state, all the subunit has to be in the R state. The one which is oxygen bound, and the other one even which doesn't have oxygen bound. Okay. But again, because only one oxygen molecule is bound, majority remains in the T state, and small fraction is in the R state. When you move to the state which is right here, you have three oxygen molecules bind to the three subunit. Now, the larger fraction of hemoglobin is in the R state. All four subunits are in the R state, and smaller fraction is in the T state. When all oxygen, all subunits are in the oxygen bound form, now the R state is strongly failing. So 99.9% of the protein is in the R state. Does it make sense? So in the concerted model, all subunits are in the T state, or all subunits are in the R state, and the binding of oxygen shifts it towards R state. More oxygen is bound, more R state. In sequential model, the model is a little different. According to this model, again, in the absence of the oxygen, you will start in the T state. But when the first molecule of oxygen binds to the first subunit, the change in the conformation in the first subunit changes the conformation of the other two subunits which are in the contact with the subunit which has oxygen bound. Okay? Changing the conformation of those two subunits increases their affinity for oxygen, so the second molecule of oxygen binds more easily. Now, when you have two molecules oxygen bound, now this one has changed conformation and this one, so either this subunit or this subunit can bind a third oxygen, but at the end you have four oxygen bound hemoglobin. So the binding of oxygen leads to the conformational change, which induces changes in the neighboring subunits, and it increases the affinity for the ligand. So, as the oxygen can be in the T state or R state, we can model the binding of oxygen to the R state and binding of oxygen to the T state that as you can see here, if the all subunits in the R state, there is high affinity for the oxygen. If all subunits in the R state, there is low affinity for oxygen, and the observed curve is the Perkermann. So what the example tells you, at low concentration of oxygen, the hemoglobin follows the T state binding. At high concentration of oxygen, the hemoglobin follows the R state, the model from R state, and somewhere between we get this sigmoidal curve, which would be the mixture of the R and T state. Are there any questions? No? Everything is clear? Okay. So, I promised you the model for the cooperative binding. If you look at the appendix on your textbook, you have a much more advanced model, which models every single oxygen binding. You can look at it, it's really interesting, but I'm not going to require it for this class. Okay, we don't have time for it. I think it's a little above the scope of this. But we still need a model which would describe this sigmoidal binding. And one model which describes it relatively well is so-called Hill equation. You may hear about it. We often use it for cooperative binding, only oxygen binding. So you remember, for myoglobin, the fraction bound was concentration of ligand divided by concentration of ligand plus concentration of ligand. In the Hill equation, you modify this equation, and if you use AB form, you provide L to N, so there is this additional parameter like the exponential factor N. If you express Hill equation using KA, now you will get this equation like this, when it's L to N over KA to N plus L to N. And if you use this equation, if N is equal to 1, you get a normal hyperbolic binding, like for myoglobin. So I use this equation to do some models that I showed you here. So if N is 1, the curve what you get is going to be a good curve. If N is going to be 2, you start to see a sigmoidal curve, which is the purple curve right here. If N is going to be 4, you will see highly sigmoidal curve corresponding to the green curve. Your N cannot be larger number of binding sites. We sometimes, and we will see it later, when we speak about allosteric enzymes, we express allosteric using allosteric constant, L, and L is the ratio of the protein in the T form divided by concentration of protein in the R form, and the zero here means that it's in the absence of the ligand. We are also interested how much more strongly R state binds oxygen than state, and this is expressed by this C parameters, which C is KR over KP. The KR and KP are the dissociation constant, so stronger binding, lower dissociation constant, so KR is smaller than KP, so it means that C must be less than 1. Okay? But this is the more binding of oxygen. Now, if you would use the binding curve for hemoglobin to bind oxygen and fit it with Hill equation, you will get N parameter, which is, now I forgot, it's either 2.4 or 2.7, okay? One of those two numbers, either 2.4 or 2.7, I think you can find it in your textbook. And so it shows you that the oxygen binding to hemoglobin is not fully cooperative, because the N is a little below the number you can, maximum number you can have, which is 4. Now, how does the cooperativity happen? I showed you at the beginning, we said that in the oxygen-free form, the position of the iron, when the iron is bound to the porphyrin group, only through those 4 nitrogen in the porphyrin ring, and the proximal histidine, right here, the iron is out of plane in the direction towards proximal histidine. Once the oxygen bond binds to the heme iron. The heme iron gets pulled up back into the center of the porphyrin ring, and so the proximal histidine gets pulled up. The proximal histidine in the structure of hemoglobin is located in so-called F-alpha helix. Okay? This F-alpha helix, a part of it, is shown right here in the purple. And once the proximal histidine moves, it like pulls the F helix up, which leads to the conformational changes at the it leads to the conformational changes. The F helix is located in the interface between alpha 1, beta 1, and alpha 2, beta 2 dimer. So it's believed that the conformational changes in the C terminal of the half helix are responsible for the communication between individual dimers in the hemoglobin, and this facilitates the transition between the T to R state. Okay, and the main mechanism is repositioning of the F helix changes its C terminal, which is communicated between individual monomers with the dimer. Now, the affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen can be regulated by other molecules or other factors. And these, we are speaking about so-called allosteric effectors or allosteric regulators. Some of them are physiological ones, we see them in our body. Some of them can be synthetic molecules, which are synthesized or simple organic molecules. And actually, there was a large interest in it. Just, you know, there was a big push from maybe 80s, 90s, trying to develop the chemical compound which would modulate the property of the hemoglobin for better blood storage, blood transfusion, etc. But we know that in nature and in our blood there is a compound which is called 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate. It's a derivative of glycerol. There is the 2-hydroxygroup on the glycerol have the hydroxy group are phosphorylated, and the third group is oxidized into the glycerin. This compound bonds to the T state of hemoglobin, and it stabilizes the hemoglobin in the T state. What it means that in the presence of this compound, the hemoglobin has little lower affinity for the oxygen. And in our body, the hemoglobin is in the 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate bound form. So this is the titration curve for hemoglobin in the red cells, because it's in the presence of this allosteric effect. So the presence of the allosteric effector stabilizes the T state. If you remove this effector from hemoglobin and you measure binding curve for hemoglobin, the binding gets stronger. And actually, in this case, the difference between oxygen-bound form and deoxyform between the lung and tissue would be only 8%. So there would be much lower efficiency of oxygen transfer to the tissue if it would have so-called strap hemoglobin. The hemoglobin has no effect on lung. But the mechanism how 2,3-BPG binds to hemoglobin again. I mentioned when I show you first time the structure of hemoglobin in the deoxy and oxygen bound form. In the deoxy form, there's a center cavity, which is not seen in the T form. And the crystal structure of the hemoglobin in the presence of 2,3-BPG shows that the BPG binds directly in the center cavity and stabilizes this conformation of hemoglobin. Again, it has 2-phosphate groups. The 2,3-BPG is a negatively charged molecule, so it forms several unique or chromic interactions, which lysine residue, which are from beta 1 subunit and beta 2 subunit, such as lysine 82, histidine 143, from both subunit and as well as histid 2. So this is the mechanism how the T state is stabilized. The other modification of hemoglobin, oh, I don't have it here. I can, if somebody is interested, I can show it. But there is so-called fetal hemoglobin. The fetal hemoglobin is in the babies before they are born. So instead of having hemoglobin, which is alpha 2 beta 2 chain, babies have so-called fetal hemoglobin, which is formed by alpha 2 chain and 2 gamma chains. So it's so-called fetal alpha 2 gamma 2 hemoglobin. And this hemoglobin does not bind to 3-DPG so well as an adult. So if you measure the titration curve or affinity curve for maternal red cells or maternal hemoglobin, which is shown in blue, it has lower affinity for oxygen than the fetal hemoglobin, which is or fetal red cells, which are shown in red. And there is a reason for it. So from the maternal blood, the oxygen has to be transported through the placenta to the baby blood or baby hemoglobin. So the baby hemoglobin has to have higher affinity for the oxygen than the maternal hemoglobin, so the oxygen can be transported to baby hemoglobin. And this is the reason it's done by the alpha 2, by the fetal hemoglobin, which has different structures, alpha 2, gamma 2. If I recall well, the beta chain, the sequence of beta chain and gamma chain are about an amino acid residue different. There are really not large differences in the sequence. The other thing I want to mention is the sea poisoning.
Yeah.
You heard about sea poisoning. What happens?
Well, I know that you, I think that you, well, you die, I think.
You die. If it's a lot of CO poisoning, you die.
Okay.
Well, I don't think we have so much of CO. Oh, and of course, we can have CO poisoning. CO poisoning, whenever anything burns, the carbon from organic molecules is converted into CO2. However, at low concentration of oxygen, if it's so-called not, the burning is not complete, instead of forming CO2, only carbon monoxide is formed. If carbon monoxide gets into our lungs, it can bind to hemoglobin, because the affinity of carbon monoxide for hemoglobin is stronger than oxygen. So it replaces by maybe 10 to 100 times, one or two orders stronger. So in hemoglobin, the CO binds into the position where oxygen binds, and because the CO binds more strongly than oxygen, it cannot be replaced by oxygen so easily. In such case, the hemoglobin cannot transport oxygen to the tissue. There is no oxygen for a respiratory chain. It inhibits respiratory chain and people dies. The only way if people have oxygen at chamber close in the chamber is higher concentration of oxygen than in the air, because when you saturate now blood with the oxygen, because you have more oxygen than CO, the oxygen will replace the CO and restore the function of oxygen and the hemoglobin. Respiratory chain, but it's a very serious condition, and I think mainly during the winter when people use those fireplaces for wood and coal, which are not well regulated, small amount of oxygen, this may happen. So carbon monoxide binds more tightly to the hemoglobin. It stabilizes our state such that the oxygen cannot bound. Well, we don't have time for cyanide poisoning. The other type of the effect I want, which happens on the physiological conditions, is so-called Bohr's effect. Now, during the Krebs cycle, which is one of the cycle of the metabolism, when sources, energy sources such as glucose undergo oxidations, in the Krebs cycles, during the oxidation of the, let's say, glucose, the carbon from the glucose is oxidized into carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is released into the blood, and in the blood, carbon dioxide undergoes conversion into H2CO3, and H2CO3 is a weak acid, so it dissociates into the protons plus HCO3-. Okay. Now, presence of the protons in the blood leads to the small decrease in the pH in the blood, and those protons can bind to the hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is in the blood. Such protonated hemoglobin, stabilizes the T state of the hemoglobin. And actually, the protonation happened at the N-terminal amino group of alpha subunit and C-terminal histidine of the beta subunit, and both those stabilizes the T state. When the hemoglobin is in the T state, it has lower affinity for oxygen, so it stimulates oxygen release. Does it make sense? So the effect is the response of pH of the decreases because the release of salt into the blood, pH decreases, the protons binds to the hemoglobin, deprotonated histidine 2, which is at the histidine, which is at the in the beta subunit, it stabilizes the state, which leads to the release of the oxygen. Now, why is it important? The hemoglobin delivers oxygen to the tissue, and the tissue is energetically active. There is a lot of metabolism. So if the Krebs cycle, which products CO2, is active, there will be need for oxygen in the respiratory chain. Okay, because the other products of the Krebs cycles are the substrates for the respiratory chain. So the respiratory chain will need the oxygen. So to facilitate the oxygen release for hemoglobin and its transfer to the respiratory chain, the change in the pH because of production of CO2, the drop of the pH leads to the stabilization of the T state of hemoglobin, which then leads to the decrease of affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen and a release oxygen for hemoglobin. Does it make sense? It's like the two different things get together. Does it make sense? So the Bohr effect is not this equation here, the solubility of the CO2 into H2CO3. Actually, we will speak about this reaction later. This reaction is enzymatically catalyzed by carbon dioxide anhydrase, which is interesting enzyme. And the reaction, when it's catalyzed, happens really fast. They have about a soap molecule, which is hydrated per second. Okay, so the reaction is really fast, which leads to the small drop in pH. This drop of the pH leads to the stabilization of the T state of hemoglobin by protonating hemoglobin and the release of the oxygen molecule. And here is an example. At pH 4, 7.4, this is the titration curve for hemoglobin. When the pH drop, hemoglobin gets protonated due to the Bohr's effect, its affinity for hemoglobin decreases by stabilization of the T state. So now the difference, the oxygen-bound and unbound hemoglobin between lungs and tissue at pH 7.4 is only 66%. When the pH dropped by 0.2 units, this difference is 77%. As I mentioned previously, the residues which are protonated are the histidine in the beta chain, and the lysine histidine in the beta chain and terminus of the alpha chain, and the histidine, which is histidine 164, form a salt bridge between the aspartate 94, and it's this presence of the salt bridge is believed to be important for the stabilization of the T-stain. And how many perfect, we will finish the chapter 7 today. Mutations in the genes coded for hemoglobin are interesting chapter. There are several mutations which can happen in the hemoglobin side chain. Even being characterized, I spoke about those more when I'm teaching biological chemistry too. For this class, I would like to mention only one case, which is a sickle cell anemia. It's a genetic disease which is caused by single mutation when when the glutamate in the native hemoglobin beta chain is substituted by valine. And the sickle cell anemia can be fatal when both alleles, which code for beta chains, are mutated. When we have only sickle cell trait, so only one allele is mutated and one is normal, such individuals are asymptomatic. So, the hemoglobin with this mutation is called hemoglobin S. And because of the valine in the hemoglobin S, this hemoglobin, the valine is exposed to the surface in the deoxyhemoglobin, makes the deoxyhemoglobin to be more hydrophobic, having the surface more hydrophobic. Such hydrophobic surfaces from different hemoglobin from different molecules of hemoglobin can interact through hydrophobic interactions, and they form the aggregates which deform the red cell blast. And such deformed, misshaped red blood cells can block the flow of the blood through capillaries, and it leads to the tissue damage. And you have the example here on this picture. There is the normal red blood cells. However, the red blood cells which have hemoglobin, which is a sickle cell hemoglobin, with the mutations, they form this strange, you know, shape, which can block the capillaries, and it does not deliver oxygen efficiently. And you have examples on the hemoglobin molecules. Such modified hemoglobin molecules, instead of forming this soluble globular protein, they form those fibers. And formation of such fibers leads to such a sickle cells, blood cells in this shape. This is just a picture. So in the valine residue is shown here in blue, and it's in those fibers interact with the other hydrophobic residues, such as valine 88, phenylalanine 85, which are located right here. And those hydrophobic interactions form those insoluble aggregates which cannot deliver oxygen efficiently. And this is all for chapter 7. Are there any questions? No, it was a long lecture today. I know it's a lot, but so the class, is everyone okay having exam 2 to be next Friday?
Yes.
Yes.
Professor, if exam 2 is next Friday, when would exam 3 be?
Well, as I said, let me again Friday exam 2 for next Friday, which is June. Somebody can help.
I mean, Monday wouldn't hurt.
Well, so the point is here, if we have it next Friday is June, so the final exam is going to be June 19th, okay? So we can do Friday first, and have third exam on Friday 12 and final exam on Friday 19. If we are going to have the second exam Monday 8, we will have third exam Monday 15 and the final exam Monday 19.
Okay.
So, but if I move it for Monday 8, you will have more stuff to study for exams 2 than if it's on a Friday 5th. There would be one more chapter.
Right. Right.
So the days are 8,
15, 19? So the date are either we will have exam 2 June 5, June 5th, and exam 3 12, or we will have exam 2 June 8 and exam 3 June 15. The exam, the final exam has to be June 19. It's going to be June 19, the last day of the process.
Oh, okay.
I think the second exam would be better on the 5th instead of the 8th.
So, if it's on Friday 5th, there would be less to study for second exam than if it's on June 8th.
If it's that's fine. Now that you put it that way, that's better.
Yeah.
So, I feel a little more comfy to put it June 5th than June 8th, okay?
Yeah,
but I am open to questions. June 8th? Who wants really June 8th instead of June 5th? Okay. Nobody speaks up, so the exam number 2 will be next week on June 1st.
What chapters do we need to know for the next exam?
So, for the next exam is going to be chapter 5, chapter 7, and chapter 8.
And for exam 3, do you know the chapters?
Sorry?
For exam 3, do you know which chapter?
No, I don't have a crystal ball, no.
Okay.
Okay. Any more questions?
Professor, you put to submit the take-home assignment, the take-home exam for 11:59 today, p.m.
Oh, I put it for p.m.? I don't put it at 1 p.m., I put it at 11?
Yeah, 11:59.
Well, good for you, you have more time. I made a mistake, I mentioned 1 p.m., but it's 11, so good for you. Okay.
And the homework is already there, right, for these assignments?
I will check on it, okay? So I will post chapter 7 and put maybe already on.
In fact.
And I will check on the homework, okay? And I will post the recording from Wednesday this week and from today.
Seems like in the big section of the class, the assignment, the take-home exam is due at 12, but in the small section, it's due at 1. So,
Okay, well, okay, I will go and, okay. So, it's vital you told me 11 now.
Actually, no, that's right, because someone else told me that it was due at 1 today, and I looked on mine, and it says 11:59 p.m.
So, I will change it for everyone for 11 p.m., okay?
Thank you.
Professor.
11 p.m. today?
Sorry?
11 p.m. today?
11 p.m. today, yes.
Professor, and are you going to put a practice exam for 2 or...
Yeah, I can post the practice exam for example.
Professor, for the take-home exam, You didn't give us the molecular weight for hemoglobin. Was that on purpose, or you just forgot to put it on the table?
It was on purpose, because you should know already. If I tell any one of you how much is myoglobin, everyone should tell me how much is hemoglobin. We cover it in chapter 2. In addition, guys, this is a home take exam, so you can open the textbook, your textbook, and find it there within, you know, 1 minute. You can find it online, okay? This is not a kindergarten, okay?
No, yeah, I just meant, like, because maybe you didn't want us to use, like, some techniques based on size. That's not because I couldn't find the molecular weight, just because you didn't want us to use, like, a technique based on size. So that's why you didn't use molecular weight.
And this was just let you to figure it out.
Yeah. That's why I asked, because I wasn't sure, like, that same thing that the other girl was saying. I didn't know if you didn't have to do something specific on molecular weight.
No, I didn't put it because it's something you should be able to figure by yourself.
Okay, so one question. You said that you were gonna post the homework today, right? So,
yes, this afternoon.
Okay, good, thank you.
Right. Something else.
No.
So have a nice weekend.
You too, Professor. Thank you.
Have a nice weekend and work on biochemistry.
Safe, Professor.
Thank you.